Welcome to Comm 100, Mass Media and Society. I'm your instructor, Catherine Clinch. Last week, as we started the first session of this course, tragic events were unfolding in Tucson, Arizona. A man fired into a crowd with a definite target. He sprayed 33 bullets. When it was over, 6 people lost their lives, and 16 others were seriously injured. We're going to take this teachable moment and look to see the ways that mass media may or may not have contributed to the events as they unfolded. First, we're going to start with the learning objectives, because after all, there is a purpose for what we're doing today. By the end of this session, students will be able to understand the impact disposable media has on society. Students will be able to demonstrate the emotional connection created by rhetoric and slogans. And students will be able to analyze the psychological power of certain words and phrases that are used in media headlines. Now that we're living in Marshall McLuhan's global village, our awareness of self and others has expanded to a point where we can barely keep up. Think of all the images that you're exposed to throughout the day, whether it's in home, on television, on radio, via computer, out of home on billboards, on bus bench signs. You are constantly bombarded with images. All of these are contributing to the person that you have become today. And by tomorrow, you'll have further influences. And all of this is building up to a critical mass inside of all of us. The key is to understand what's happening so that we can manage it effectively. Now, with mobile phones, we are always connected. When bosses give them to you, they are often jokingly referred to as the gift that keeps on taking, because they can hunt you down 24/7, and they will. All phones now come with some kind of a long-distance plan attached, because you want to keep in touch with the people who are out of your basic locality. A lot of them come with both national and international calling plans. It's additional, but if you're from another country, you want to keep in touch with your homeland. You want to follow the local news there. You don't necessarily want to lose touch with your culture unless you come here as a deliberate attempt to do so. We have text messages. I have 3 sons who are now in college, and for the last couple of years, I have become a non-stop texter. It's easier for them to check it while they're in class or if they're out with friends, and now I have to go, "Hi, Mom." AOL instant message. Think about it. Instant message, AIM. Everybody has an AIM name, and it goes right to them if they're on computer. So while they're doing one thing, they can multitask over and see what you want them to look at. There's also Facebook chat. I find this fascinating because anytime that I see my sons are on Facebook and I want to chat with them, oh, they're offline really fast. That being said, it's a really good way to keep up with business contacts, and some of us who are older have Facebook friends who are, in fact, business colleagues. Twitter, on your mobile phone. This is an interesting thing. Twitter is like the haiku of modern communication because you can only use 140 characters. It really forces you to edit your thoughts into one salient point. But if it comes up on your mobile phone, you're getting them all day, every day. By the way, you can follow me at #CatherineClinch. We also have email updates. If you subscribe to news aggregators, you are likely getting breaking news reports as they unfold. And different aggregators are taking great pride in being the first person on the scene and the first company to know, "We broke the news." Now, this is an ongoing motif throughout mass media all across the way. Who's got the breaking news first? Who's on the scene first? Who has the most details first? And one of the reasons for that is that we have a primal drive to gather information. We are looking to be as informed as we possibly can, and we want to be able to keep up with everything, because we don't want to be the one who's saying, oh, you know that. Or someone comes and says, you heard? We want to immediately be able to contribute to the conversation with a personal insight of sorts. So, if you go back to Sir Francis Bacon, who in 1597 coined the phrase, knowledge is power, this is one of the controlling metaphors for development of society. We also like pretty packages because they appeal to our sensibility. So if we're getting our news from magazines or from broadly designed websites, we are enjoying the appeal, the visual appeal. Now, mobile phones and iPads also have a very cool appeal, because if you look at the interface now, where you go on and you start picking which apps you're going to go to, it's visually appealing. And the reason for that is, subconsciously, it makes us want to use the tool more. And the more we use it, the more they can charge us for it. Now, current events. This is an important term in mass media, because it's what's happening right now. This week, I didn't know about the shooting. It happened shortly before we arrived. My husband turned off the news when I got in the car. And that was good, because I would have been concerned about people. I would have been thinking. However, as we watch what's happening in the exact moment now, the preponderance of media enables us to go through and see all different perspectives. We're going to talk about the different ways that news spins story. But the bottom line is that in the media, someone has to determine what is newsworthy. It's led by both news directors and editors in one form or another. These people are human beings. They have human emotions. They are subject to personal opinion, no matter how objective they try to be. They have opinions about what they're seeing, and that's normal and that's good, because if they didn't, they might as well be machines. But their decisions on what to air and how to air it are not always objective. And that specific point of view is called the spin. We're going to be talking about spin throughout this whole session. Reports of news have historic resonance. We may not know it, but down the line, something may happen to one of the individuals involved in the Arizona shooting that suddenly has historical resonance. What if that person had been killed? Or what if this person had not survived? We would not have X, Y, and Z taking place in 20 years from now. The unknown impact at the time of the recording is something that reporters and editors and everyone else involved really have to take into consideration. Because while they're watching events unfold, it may in fact be the tipping point of something. Now, the world is moving at such a rapid pace that yesterday's news really is yesterday's news. It's ephemera in many ways. Now, ephemera is something that is considered to have no lasting significance. It is predominantly paper-based. It is disposable. It rose to prominence at the turn of the last century, from 19th to 20th. And the Industrial Revolution, with improved printing presses, enabled ephemera to be much more prevalent. There was less preciousness to a piece of paper. It wasn't always handmade. It was machine-made. It was machine-printed. And so it was considered disposable, and we hear the reference of newspapers lining the bottom of bird cages or wrapping up fish. Now, often, ephemera had lasting significance because there was some kind of an emotional connection to the person who decided to keep it, and the person who later decided that it was charming and lovely and they wanted to collect it. And so it became collectible. And I'm going to show you some examples of ephemera right now, because, as it turns out, I really like it. The kind of ephemera might be either a sticker, or, let's go to the overhead shot, a tag of something, or a promotional item. This is a promotional family snapshot of the Royal Tenenbaums. Here's a sticker for everything you need to know to write the story of your dreams. It's writing software. Now, beyond that, we have labels. This is a reenactment, a recreation of some very charming turn of the century into the, let's say, 30s. Kind of labels that are now being sold at Paper Source, which is one of my favorite places to hang out. But here we have scrapbooking reenactments of the kind of ephemera that people might have saved. A war ration book over here, or stamps, or fake military ribbons. We also have people would cut out phrases from a magazine to be captions. Here are tags. Tags are very, very big in ephemera, as are stamps. Now, because it's so hard to go out and actually find these anymore, some very savvy scrapbooking companies have decided to recreate them, design them, manufacture them, and distribute them widely. Another kind of ephemera, which happens very frequently in scrapbooks, is people who take something like a map and cut out shapes or letters and use that as a way to describe a caption to what was being illustrated by it. Now, indeed, I am a scrapbooker, and these are my midlife crisis. And that's not necessarily a bad thing, because there's a lot of worse things you could be doing with your time. But there is something precious. I was very close to my grandparents and my great-grandmother. And so when I see things like that, it reminds me of the times that I spent with them when I was a child. Now, how much of what is designated as current event is actually an ephemeral event that seems to have no impact or care bearing on our future? We can only know that in retrospect. So we have to be really careful about what we decide to use and not use. News cycle is an important term. News cycle is a 24-hour period in the news. Now, there's three phases to this. Media reports on an event. At this point, they really don't know what they have, but they're reporting everything that they can. And you'll typically see a news reporter on camera, and the fellow who's behind the desk in the newsroom is saying, "What do you know now?" And they're saying, "Well, we talked to someone, they said this, we don't have a verification yet." But they're trying to piece the pieces of the puzzle together. It's like when you get a bunch of puzzle pieces, and you don't have the cover of the box, but you look and say, well, some of it's blue, some of it's green. Let's assume the sky is the blue part, and the green is the grass. And once you put the pieces together, you discover you're doing it upside down. In fact, the blue is water, and the green are overhanging trees, but you don't know that until you get enough pieces of the puzzle together. So that's the first phase. The second is the media starts recording public responses. As we talk to a person who said this, there's a witness on the scene, here's an interview with them, we start to get more dimension to the story. Finally, the pundits start to weigh in. Now, this is where you get to what I call the spin cycle, because speculation, this is a really dangerous part of media reporting. Because when someone is saying, well, this is what it can mean, and we don't even have all the pieces, if someone's not obsessively staying with that news report for a long period of time, that's all they're taking away. And they will accept that because it's officially reported in the news media. How much of this analysis is actually impacting things as the story unfolds? We've all seen the reports that say, while the person was barricaded in the house, they had the news on. They knew where our survivors were. They knew where the SWAT team was positioned, and it made it harder for the cops to do their jobs. Now, all news outlets compete. And they do this because they want to be the first to break the story. Remember, we were first on the scene, breaking news, we will bring it to you. The next kind of competition is what's called the biggest get. Who did you get to interview? If you're on the scene and you get the person who is holding the representative as she was shot, that's considered an amazing get because that person has knowledge no one else might have. You also want to have the most sensational details. This is where they get you. There's a phrase in news called, if it bleeds, it leads. When you see blood, it triggers an emotion inside of you that says, fever, tension, find out what's wrong, it's an adrenaline rush. You also want to have the reporters who are working for you have the best sources. So it comes down to, who do you know? Remember, when Woodward and Bernstein were going after Richard Nixon in the Watergate days, it was the information that came to them from Deep Throat that actually helped them build the story. Deep Throat was their deep background source. You have two kinds of sources. You have on and off the record, and you have deep background. So the people who will talk to give you information are one thing. The people who will tell you what that information means are much more valuable. Newspapers. They were the strongest mass media during the Industrial Revolution. They've been around since we first had the origins in America. And you had all the different businesses in the local papers, and it was typically one sheet, and it was printed, and the whole town would come to the town square to look at it. Gradually, as printing presses improved, as paper became more available, they would deliver it. They would, or you'd come by at the newsstand, or the little boy would stand on the street and sell the paper to you. However, once the Industrial Revolution came along, the machinery was in place that enabled them to make cheaper paper easier. There were improved techniques and methods, so they were able to save money and increase the amount of production that they did. And newspapers were typically owned by wealthy or powerful people in the community. The Chandler family, with the Los Angeles Times, was very influential in building the city of Los Angeles because the powerful and the wealthy had a personal benefit. They got prestige from owning the paper. There was a financial benefit because it was a profit-making enterprise. But they had political power. If they told the right story about the right person, that person was elevated. And if they told the right story about another person they didn't necessarily side with, that person could be destroyed. We're going to take a look now at a clip of Citizen Kane. It's a wonderful moment where we learn exactly how to run a newspaper from the point of view of the wealthy, powerful individual. Let's take a look.
Is that really your idea? How to run a newspaper?
I don't know how to run a newspaper, Mr. Thatcher. I just try everything I can think of.
Sergeant, you know perfectly well there's not the slightest proof of this armada of the Jersey
Coast.
Excuse me, Mr.
Can you prove it isn't? Mr. Bernstein, I'd like you to meet Mr. Thatcher.
I'll just talk to
Mr. Thatcher, my ex-guardian. We have no secrets from our readers, Mr. Bernstein. Mr. Thatcher is one of our most devoted readers. He knows what's wrong with every copy of the Inquirer since I took over. Read the cable.
Girls, delightful and humorous stop.
Could send you prose poems about scenery, but don't feel right spending your money. Stop. There is no war in Cuba. Signed, Wheeler. Any answer?
Yes, Dale Wheeler. You provide the prose poems. I'll provide the war.
That's good, Mr. King.
Yes, I rather like myself.
I came to see you about this campaign of yours.
Some kind of campaign against the Public Transit Company.
Mr. Thatcher, do you know anything we could use against them?
Still the college boy, aren't you?
Oh, no, Mr. Thatcher. I was expelled from college. A lot of colleges, you remember. I remember.
Charles, I think I should remind you of a fact that you seem to have forgotten.
Yes.
You are yourself one of the largest individuals in the Public Transit Company.
The trouble is you don't realize you're talking to two people. As Charles Foster Kane, who owns 82,364 shares of Public Transit, preferred, you see, I do have a general idea of my holdings. I sympathize with you. Charles Foster Kane is a scoundrel. His paper should be run out of town. A committee should be formed to boycott him. You may, if you can form such a committee, put me down for a contribution of $1,000. On the other hand, I am the publisher of the Inquirer. Such is my duty, and I'll let you in on a little secret. It's also my pleasure. See to it that decent, hard-working people in this community aren't robbed blind by a pack of money-mad pirates just because they haven't anybody to look after their interests. I'll let you in on another little secret, Mr. Thatcher. I think I'm the man to do it, you see. I have money and property. If I don't look after the interests of the underprivileged, maybe somebody else will. Maybe somebody without any money or property.
Yes, yes,
that
yes.
Would money be too bad.
Well, I happened to see your financial statement today, Charles.
What did you?
Now, tell me honestly, my boy, don't you think it's rather unwise to continue this philanthropic enterprise? This empire that's costing you $1 million a year?
You're right, Mr. Thatcher. I did lose $1 million last year. I expect to lose $1 million this year. I expect to lose $1 million next year. You know, Mr. Thatcher, at a rate of $1 million a year, I'll have to close this place in 60 years.
I love Citizen Kane. Everybody should watch it if you haven't seen it. I've seen it about maybe 15, 20 times over the years. Definitely a film school basis staple. Now, newspapers were the backbone of old school mass media. Now, they have a familiar role. This system has lasted over 100 years. Very simply stated in America, they helped build the 20th century. Most were printed daily, some were weekly, but most of them were daily. And it's inexpensive and accessible. You could buy a newspaper for a nickel in the early years. It's still very affordable. And because cheap paper stock and impermanent ink has become one of those things that is not a huge investment on anybody's point of view. There's an assortment that is divided into sections, because if you put all these together, you wouldn't be able to focus on what you wanted specifically. And frankly, some people go straight to the spin section. Some people would rather go to national and international first. That's usually the first section. In the front page of a newspaper, if you just walk past the newsstand and see what's above the fold, you will basically get an idea of the most important thing you know need to know that day. There's a local section, business, which has recently become my first section of choice, sports, arts and leisure, real estate, and classified goods. Now, there's also the Sunday Comics and the Sunday Magazine, and a lot of places include Parade Magazine, which is kind of the Sunday magazine of the country. Very benign. It doesn't have anything confrontational. It doesn't have anything that would challenge sensibilities. It just enables you to get an idea of a few Sunday features that you might enjoy knowing about and chatting about with your friends. Retail advertising is what ties all of these sections together. It's not circulation that pays the bills. It's the retail and classified advertising. But ad rates, being the primary income system, are actually driven by circulation, which is the secondary source. So if paper has very high circulation, they're able to charge much higher rates because the target audience is more broad for the advertiser. In the 21st century, by the very nature, newspapers publish yesterday's news. We already know what's going on. By the time the newspaper brings it, we're looking to that for some in-depth analysis. We're looking for deep background information that might not have come out yet. But what we're also doing is looking for those ads. So what's enabled newspapers to remain viable is the retail advertising, the real estate ads, because you can buy a house the only way to really, no matter how much time you are on the internet and with a real estate agent, being able to look at the information that's available to you in the paper is much more efficient. And if you don't have a house, or if you have a house and you want to know how much it's worth today, you want to be able to get an idea from those sections. Classified ads. While many of the white-collar jobs are available on the internet, part of the blue-collar, middle-class, service-oriented, skill-oriented jobs are available through the classified section. And then, let us not forget, and this may be the primary reason I still subscribe to the LA Times over 30 years, grocery coupons. But even at the end of that, pretty much helps pay for the whole subscription, if not much more. Now, we're paying for them to deliver this advertising to our door. In 2007, there were 6,580 daily newspapers in the world. Think about that. That's a lot of paper. 395 million copies of a newspaper were printed every day. By 2008, with the recession and rapid growth of web-based alternatives, there was a decline in advertising and circulation, because remember, those two things go hand in hand. Now, the three largest national newspapers in order of largest circulation in the United States are, number one, USA Today. It's distributed everywhere. You can buy it on the newsstands, you can pick it up for free in any hotel you're staying at around the country. It is very easy to read. If you have a high school education, it is not going to push your skill set any farther beyond that. Second, this is a surprise to me, the Wall Street Journal. And now this is like night and day, because the Wall Street Journal is definitely for people who have got at college, preferably some kind of graduate or professional school. It's a very high-end level of the news. There's no fluff whatsoever. And third is the New York Times, which is considered the newspaper of record for around the world. This is the newspaper I grew up reading. This is the newspaper that made me want to be a professional writer. And I think that there's a lot of things to be said for looking at the level of inspiration that comes to you from the source of the news that's being delivered to you. We're going to take a look now at an image of the Pew Study. And we're going to go full screen on this, please, so you can see this there. Now, where do you get most of your news about national and international issues? Notice a significant decline in television and in newspapers. Where are we on newspapers? Over here. Both of those have had significant drops. And part of the reason for that, and by the way, notice radio has remained constant over here, And the reason for that is we spend so much time in our cars. Now, by the same token, the internet has gone from 13 to 41. That's an enormous increase. And part of the reason is because there's been a transition onto that as a substitute for all that paper we're printing. But things are not always what they seem. Let's come back. Every newspaper has some kind of an online presence. Newspapers aren't dying, no matter what they say. They are transforming. If you look at the website for the New York Times, for the Los Angeles Times, or any other paper, it bears a striking resemblance in the way the news is presented. The graphics are different. But the news is presented in a very similar format. It is transforming. They have a video and audio and very splashy graphics. You'll have moving banner ads. You'll have things flashing. But the news stories, here's the big benefit of going online. They're updated as events unfold. So it's no longer yesterday's news. And here's where the problem comes. In the early stages, it was a predominantly free source of news. They didn't have a business model. They said, well, let's put it up. Let's see if we can support it by banner ads. It'll be an adjunct. Banner ad prices were untested, so the ad agencies and the different brands didn't want to spend a lot of money on them, so they relied on click-through rates. But click-through rates were not always the most reliable because they were subject to, I don't want to say tampering, but certainly if your opposition wants you to pay a lot of money for ads, they can go in and click on those ads 25 times every minute, and you're paying for those click-throughs, but you're not getting the benefit of return on investment because they're not going to buy anything. And there was a downward spiral because with the declining subscriptions at the newsstand and delivery to your home, decreasing ad rates based on circulation, there's decreased profits. And so the different newspaper organizations are scampering to try to find a way to increase new revenue streams. But the consumers are saying, why should I pay for this when I'm getting it for free? Especially if you subscribe to the newspaper, you want to get it for free. Now, that's been established as we're going to have to do it. If they pay for a regular subscription, we're going to have to give them a website, too. But they're starting to set up what's called a paywall. Now, a paywall is a paid subscription to an online newspaper. Let's start with the Wall Street Journal. From the very beginning, the Wall Street Journal said, you know what? Our audience is affluent, white-collar bankers, attorneys, CPAs, for professionals. They can afford to pay for the newspaper online. So that paid model from the beginning isn't shocking anybody's sensibilities. It occasionally opens a free portal to allow news aggregators to link to a story, but they use that as an opportunity to then sell subscriptions. The New York Times, which was established in 1851, and originally cost a penny an issue, so you can see that they were geared up to being accessible to everyone. I want to read you the editorial from the inaugural issue, because I think it's very interesting in the way that it establishes what the paper is and has been. We shall be conservative in all cases where we think conservatism is essential to the public good, and we shall be radical in everything which may seem to us to require radical treatment and radical reform. We do not believe that everything in society is either exactly right or exactly wrong. What is good we desire to preserve and improve, what is evil to exterminate or reform. That's almost the way they're deciding how to do their new business model, because they have to make a radical change in order to support the same news gathering that was being paid for by the subscriptions and by the advertising. So the newspaper of record, which is actually worldwide, I mean, you can go to any other country and people know what the New York Times is, previously free online content is planning to move behind a paywall this spring. Consumers feel this is a violation. It should be free. Everything on the internet should be free, which we're going to discover is not going to be the next level of the business model. Because the New York Times has stated blankly, free is not a good business model for a news gathering organization. Now, cable and news broadcast both show a decline. So let's take this image to full screen, too, please, for a minute. If you're getting your news from television, which is where most people are getting it now, do you get most of your news from cable news networks, broadcast? Well, we need to go to the next one, please. Or was it the last one? Did we miss one here? We had a goof, because we've already done this one. Well, we're just going to keep going. Cable and broadcast both declined. Local news remains steady, and here's why. I'm sorry, someone else made clicks on there. The clicks are still on from my last time. I apologize. Local news programming over here is steady, 16 to 16. And the reason for that is, let's go back to full screen. I'm sorry. Local news, if you travel the country and stop in places like Provo, Utah, they need to know more about what's going on in their community than what is going on in the rest of the world, because it is a much smaller, I'm trying to get instructions here on what to do, there's a much smaller frame of reference in their daily existence. Broadcast network news is on a decline, not drastically, but enough. And then finally, if you look at the cable news networks, they're still the primary way that people are getting their news, but they are still subject to interpretation. So let's take a look at the different cable news networks. I'm sorry about that. Fox News. Fox News is the highest rated cable news channel that's on the airwaves right now. It is very conservative. It is blatantly Republican. They make no bones about it. And they pride themselves on fiery political rhetoric. Okay? Now, again, remember, the spin is one of those things that stays with us for a very long time. It impresses the audience. If you are a true believer, you want to look at the things that reinforce your beliefs. And so Fox has a very powerful impact on the conservative Republican base, so to speak. CNN, on the other hand, which is my default channel, CNN is not quite as biased. I believe they're pretty balanced, which is the reason I choose to watch them. If they have two Republican pundits, they have two Democrat pundits next to them, so that they're absolutely having a balanced discussion. Now, in 1980, CNN was created by Ted Turner, who actually invented the 24/7 news. He was the first one to realize that the news didn't stop at 11 o'clock, and that not everybody went to bed then, and that things needed to be followed and made public. So the 80s began with 24/7 news, and I don't know if Turner ever foresaw how big it would get, how widespread it would get. Be that as it may, ratings on CNN have been diminishing. Even talk reporters can't deliver high ratings. Campbell Brown was in a wonderful program, and it was amazing and fabulous to watch, but she wasn't pulling in the audience. CNN has frequently been accused of leaning left, but I think it's very centrist because there is a good balance, and both sides are always represented. CNBC. Now, this is the consumer news and business channel. NBC, in this case, does not stand for National Broadcasting Company. It is Consumer News and Business Channel. It was a combination of business news and commentary. That's MSNBC behind me. It is mostly stocks and bonds and financial markets. MSNBC, on the other hand, is Microsoft and NBC. It's a separate freestanding company. NBC recently acquired a controlling interest, and it's also accused of having a liberal bias. Then there is my favorite. The BBC World News Report. The BBC stands for British Broadcast System. BBC is the most fascinating spin on things. Because remember, we are not from the British, but we are of them. Or we are from them, but not of them. And they tend to look at us as those amusing folks on the other side of the pond. Now, cultural differences are enormous. And we can frequently rely on the fact that there is truth to the phrase, two people divided by a common language. However, all of the cable news networks have specific bias in their reporting, and this is not a new phenomenon. The thing that BBC does add to is that they're in Europe, and so when events are unfolding on the other side of the world, we're able to get a different perspective and possibly more news analysis because of that Eurocentric approach. I grew up in a three-newspaper household. My mother read the New York Times. My grandpa read the Daily News, and my grandma, former Cicada girl, read the Daily Mirror. She also read the Inquirer and a bunch of other tabloids. But all of these three newspapers, the Times, the News, and the Mirror, have specific demographics, and they spun news to reach their demographics. The interesting thing about New York is when you go there, everybody reads newspapers. The cab drivers read newspapers, the bus drivers, the people who work in the deli and the pizza parlor are reading the newspaper. It is a very informed community, and that might be one of the things that keeps it thriving so successfully. While demographic appeal is not a new phenomenon, speed is. Now, Bruce Feiler, who is a Christian author who writes about faith and family and finding meaning in modern life, has been attributed as the source of what's called the Feiler Cluster Thesis. His theory proposes that the faster the news is reported, the more people want to consume the news. So the audience is adapted to the speed of delivery and has come to expect no less. Often stories get rushed past the first two stages. Remember, they'll breeze through recording the events and getting public opinion of witnesses and go right to the pundits with the analysis. But analyzing a story before a significant number of facts are discovered and speculating about what might be discovered and further speculation about what might be discovered might mean. This is a dangerous game. Speculation should not have any place in the news reporting. This is the last thing you do. You analyze and speculate after that. Remember the War of the Worlds. People felt that they were hearing a factual news reporting, responded accordingly. When people hear analysis, they believe that they're getting the actual factual opinion on what's going on. That's not always the case. Too many people assume that everything that they read in the papers is true. Those beliefs are shaped by erroneous facts. Speed increases the competition and increases the potential for erroneous facts, while reporters are working in stealth mode trying to outscoop each other. Now, as events unfold, this is another aspect that we have to take close examination in. There's instant reportage. There's an adrenaline rush for the reporters and for the audience. We are there in the moment and we are having vicarious experience. As events unfold, you're sitting there watching it. If you're watching TV news and they've got the helicopter shots, the perspective is what I call the eye of God. We are looking down on something we cannot control, almost as if it's a set of game pieces. We are watching from an omniscient point of view, and we're not getting full details, we're getting the overhead shots. Now, as events unfold, is the most dangerous time for the analysis and speculation to begin. But we're going to look at a new element that comes in, the rhetoric. Rhetoric is the art of using language effectively or persuasively. Rhetoric is something that I studied extensively in grad school. I majored in speech communications, and rhetoric was a prime focus of the study. Fiery political rhetoric has been mentioned recently in the news repeatedly. Should we have so much fiery political rhetoric? Do we have enough? Should we have more? Is it really incendiary? Let's take a look at one individual who seemed to react to it. This is Jerry Loughner, the fellow who pulled the Glock 9mm pistol in Tucson, Arizona last week. He looked at images of target crosshairs that suggested that it's time to take a stand. The caption on one specific image that he saw repeatedly was, "Join me today." Now, in the hands of an individual who was subject to personal opinion that had been rallied by fiery political rhetoric, chaos happened. Catastrophe happened. Tragedy resulted. Let's assume Sarah Palin, who is responsible for those crosshair images, let's assume her intent was totally innocent and an attempt at being clever. It seems to be. She's very personable when she's on camera. She's got that folksy kind of, hey, y'all, you know, let's do all these things and let's be a grizzly mama bear and all of that. So crosshairs were just another kind of image she might have thought she could use for getting attention. certain candidates were targeted in a campaign to be replaced by Republican and Tea Party candidates. After the shooting, the uh-oh moment indicated it might have been a terrible gaffe. Opponents suggested that the crosshairs combined with rhetoric incited the shooting. A Palin tried to take her crosshairs image off, but once it's on the internet, it is forever. This is something we're all telling our kids in social media. Once you post something on the internet, you can never take it back. Because it's been reposted in so many places, it was played out on all the media sources. And Palin's media statement pushed her foot deeper into her mouth. We're going to take a look at a clip that reported on this actual incident. Let's take a look.
Role for presidents in times of tragedy, consoler in chief.
Sadly, it has, Katie, and as you can see from these pictures, he's going to have a very large crowd to hear his remarks. Thousands of people are being diverted to an outdoor stadium where they'll get a feed of the remarks. One thing we're told he will not do is get into the political battle that's developed over this tragedy, a battle that became even more heated today when Sarah Palin joined the fray.
That is reprehensible.
In a nearly eight-minute video, Sarah Palin defended herself against critics who've accused her of using inflammatory, even violent words and images in last year's campaign, especially a map that used the crosshairs of a gun sight to target some Democrats, including Gabrielle Giffords. Today, Palin said it's not she, but her critics who are inciting violence.
Journalists and pundits should not manufacture a blood libel that serves only to incite the very hatred and violence that they purport to condemn.
But she ignited a new controversy by using the term blood libel. It refers to false allegations from the Middle Ages that Jews murdered Christian children to use their blood in religious ceremonies.
Jews paid a terrible price, but they were accused falsely. Their children were murdered because of these libels.
But some political analysts say the remark was straight out of Sarah Palin's political playbook.
And she will often make her case in the most explicit, most inflammatory, most attention-getting way that's possible.
Again, we're told the president will not take sides in that battle. He'll spend most of his short speech memorializing the victims. Katie?
Chip Reed reporting from Tucson tonight.
Okay, blood libel, as you heard, refers to a 12th century allegation that Jews kidnapped a boy and used his blood to perform their rituals and to create the unleavened bread they call matzah. Anti-Semitic sentiment was enormous after that. But part of the fiery political rhetoric is focused on the Christian point of view toward the Jews, toward their amount of influence and power in the world. And so this may not have been as casual as one might think that she tossed it off the top of her head. But the real irony here is that Representative Gabrielle Giffords, who was involved in this, who was the target of this, is Jewish. Now, Sarah Palin's Facebook page had this image. And you can see it still has the crosshair image. The Representative Gabrielle Giffords' name and district are on the list beneath the illustration in the crosshair, so right here. Okay? And here is her district, right over there. So, when you look at this and you see new crosshairs, or you target them, join with me now. This is problematic. Now, the discussion that follows all of this demeans the idea that Zadok alerted to shoot one of the people on the list. The Republicans are saying you absolutely cannot blame somebody who gets a gun, and you certainly can't blame this gun. The Glock 9mm pistol, which is shown here, is what was used by Jared Lee Lochner. 2 days after the shooting, sales of this gun jumped 60% to 263 on January 10th, compared with 164 corresponding that Monday a year ago. The second biggest increase in any state in the country, according to the Federal Bureau of Investigations data. Okay? Reasons cited included a fear that the gun was going to be taken off the market. Now, indeed, let's take a look at the gun control issue. Democratic Representative Carolyn McCarthy of New York will introduce legislation to ban the extender clip that enabled him to use not 15 but 33 bullets at once from a single clip. Carolyn McCarthy ran for office in 1993 after her husband was gunned down by a lone shooter on the Long Island Railroad. This is a very personal issue to her. And it's a very personal issue to anyone who has children or wanders the street and suddenly feels vulnerable. Let's take a look now at another issue that's involved here. Propaganda. Propaganda is, at its very basis, brainwashing. Rhetoric becomes propaganda when an emotional connection is made to extreme points of view. Let's take a look at a little baby picture here. Okay? It's going to come up any second in the background. A little baby picture. Yeah, cute little boy. Okay, I have three sons. This is not one of mine. Three little boys, and I've watched them all grow, and they all have the same thing in common at this age. Their mind is totally open. It's subject to input. They are eager to be cooperative. They want smiles and laughs and hugs. They want to be told that they're valued. They want to feel good about themselves. At the same time, they are very influenced by rhetoric and emotional context. By the time this child reaches adulthood, the mass media, throughout the whole 20th century, the mass media will have shaped his opinions, his beliefs, his goals, and his trust. Now, take one more real close look at this sweet little baby and see if you can guess who it is. Nope. Let me tell you. Adolf Hitler. Adolf Hitler started here and got to where he was for a number of reasons, and one of them is conclusively determined to be the rhetoric of the day. Let's take a look at a picture of Adolf speaking at a sports fest. There is a theory that if Adolf Hitler had been accepted into art school, the Holocaust might not have happened. Jewish art teachers and gallery owners rejected his artistic skills. He ultimately found a way to reject them. Radio broadcast to the entire world, and this isn't speaking of sportscast, but reaffirmed his intention to invade Czechoslovakia. There was no way around it. We listened for the ways that his rhetoric resonates today, and his rhetoric resounding cheers. But first, I want you to take a look at what you see here. Understand that it's not very different from the typical political conventions we have today. Everyone gathers in the galleries, in the levels above, on the floor. There is a speaker whose full attention is determined there. Let's take a look now at one of Hitler's feudal speeches and see how it resonates with today.
Und wir haben ein Schlüssel, da wir die Gegend zu wachsen.
You see, there's a lot of parallels to what was going on then and what's going on now. Similar historic benchmarks of the post-depression and now our post-recession, high rates of unemployment, the disappearing middle class, foreign policy issues, as he said, decayed corruption in our administration, and blamed it on the men of November 18th, okay? He said, with the support of my party, I will save the nation. If you take a look at the rhetoric that's coming out of current fiery political rhetoric, you see a lot of comparisons to the way that the minds of the audience are being maneuvered into that same cheering mode. Mass media has an impact. If the speech were limited to the people in the room, they'd go out and say, oh yeah, he said this thing about, and they would describe it. But because this was broadcast over radio, this was his first speech as chancellor in 1933. The world was listening. I assure you the world was listening. If there had been reliance on newspapers, perhaps it would have come out. Maybe they would have put a transcript. But you wouldn't have felt the response of the audience. Word of mouth, interpretation, misquoting. Broadcast is the factor that is the impact that enabled him to create so much groundswell of support behind his motives. You heard what Hitler said, we must take action. You can see those people standing and cheering. Okay? And then there were the troops in World War II, the German troops. The results of Hitler's message were catastrophic. His rhetoric was presented in the same format as today's campaign speeches, and it encouraged thousands of men, there they are, goose-stepping their way to a battle, where they killed individual citizens for their individual religious and political beliefs. Hitler's rhetoric inspired a nation to slaughter millions of Jews. And we have to ask ourselves, why is it so hard to then believe that the same kind of fiery political rhetoric would inspire a single man to kill innocent people for their beliefs today? Now, there are significant differences between newspaper and magazines. Newspapers focus on the news of the day, as we've seen. Magazines have to have a longer shelf life. They're weekly or monthly. And while newspapers focus on hard news, magazines are interspersed with feature articles that are typically news-based, but try to lend insight into what we're doing. Magazines focus on in-depth feature articles that are personal stories. They're how to do whatever. They are news versus news analysis. They'll try to look at the personal story or the meaning behind it. It's the difference between Time, which is a news-based magazine, and Wired, which is a specific niche magazine. Forbes versus entrepreneur, the person who has achieved versus the person who's trying to achieve. We're going to take a look at magazines for the rest of this session, and I'm going to start by showing you a little clip by publishers about magazine covers telling the story of the decade. Let's take a look. Magazine cover and instantly be brought back to the specific moment of time at which it was published. Now, I subscribe to a lot of magazines. There are some I'll pick up at newsstand on occasions, but for the most part, there's a lot of paper that comes into my house. Last week, I told you that I used to be associate publisher of a magazine, and I'm going to start by showing you that because it's a specific niche. So let's start taking a look at the overhead here. There we go. Creative Screenwriting Magazine. I was in it for 12 of the first 13 years in one level of another, and then I left it as associate publisher. It is the top magazine in the niche. It is designed to fill the needs of professional and inspiring screenwriters. It is also one of the few things that actually manages to make screenwriters into heroes. We also have Produced By. This is the magazine of the Producers Guild. It is a phenomenal resource to anyone who wants to venture into that area. Ironically, even though I'm a member of the Writers Guild and made a very good living for a very long time writing network television shows, I don't have the current issue of the Writers Guild Journal. I do, however, have Computer Graphics World. I have a son who wants to go into graphic design, I'm interested in animation, and so I subscribe to this magazine. It is, again, a very significant niche. Here's a niche of computer graphics, and that's animation. Now, Animation Magazine is both a journal that will tell you who's doing what, and also have instructional information. I also get the magazine from one of my alma maters, University of South Florida. It's a really good magazine. I was very impressed to see it. It manages to take all of the things that are going on in one of the largest universities in the country and present it in a way that makes you proud to go there and inspires other people to go there as well. Now, I get Graphic Design USA, because when I was working with the magazine, I wanted to learn more about the paper, and I started getting it. And the interesting thing is that sometimes you can subscribe to a magazine, and they won't let you stop subscribing to it. Part of the reason for this is that everything in their ads is based on circulation, so they want to keep the circulation going as high as possible. Also because they figure that if you've done it once, you may be doing it again, and you all need to know that. art is my midlife crisis, and so I will typically pick up the occasional art magazine at the newsstand. And because it's back to Los Angeles Times, there is their magazine that comes through my door once a month. Furthermore, because I'm in the entertainment industry and I've become a producer as of late, expanding on being a screenwriter, I get Daily Variety. Daily Variety is the New York Times of entertainment magazines. It is the best news source, it has the most fascinating reporters, and so it develops into the top news magazine and has basically forced the Hollywood Reporter to redesign itself. Now we're going to go to the next level of magazines, she said, for a moment. Let's check it out. We have Fortune Magazine. Let's go back to the overhead. I have a very large stack here. Fortune Magazine is geared to the business person and the aspirant. It is excellent news coverage, and it has very insightful and inspiring articles in it. In the earlier stage, which I'm still at because I seem not to have developed the skill yet of raising $10 million in equity capital, Entrepreneur Magazine. They have conferences that are phenomenal. The resources they offer through the magazine itself are wonderful. I've become an enormous fan of this magazine, and the 2011 Trends issue has a lot of information that's helpful. One of my favorite magazines is Fast Company. Fast Company is hip and flashy and goes into great depth and manages to distill the most important topic issues for each of the stories. Inc. Magazine, also very effective. Much more technical, business-driven than for the aspirant. Then there's the B2B magazines. Microcap Review. The editor, Ron Stone, is a friend of mine. I think it's a wonderful magazine and is specifically designed to a niche in the market where the investment level is at one point and the amount of productivity of a company is measured at another point. Deliver magazines for marketers, because if I'm going to make a film, I'm going to have to learn how to market it. And so this started coming to me and is again B2B. Business to business, not business to consumer. And here's one of those things that once you subscribe, you can't unsubscribe. Imaging News. I want to show you the kind of thing that this magazine does. It's overhead images. It's the IQ launches. It is about satellite imaging. I started reading this magazine because I was doing a story about direct broadcast satellite systems. And when I finished, I said, thank you, I don't need this anymore, but it's still coming. And ironically, it has inspired me to think that I am now ready to go back and revisit that story. Now we're going to go into the depth that's provided of one specific magazine, Forbes. Forbes is one of the ones that I subscribe to and absolutely get enormous benefit from. But Forbes has a specific niche. Let's go back over it. The 400 richest people in America. Price of admission, $1.3 billion. It's a special issue. It comes out once a year. Here's the latest one. Now they're just the Forbes 400. Jay-Z and Warren Buffett. It's pretty much self-explanatory. The richest people in America. But Forbes is not just content with focusing on the richest. Here they are. There are 1,125 billionaires in this country. And they talk about the biggest gamer, the youngest and richest woman in China. Russia makes the top 10. It is geared to give us insight into not only where the money is, but tell us about the people who are making it. Then, Forbes, which is about money, power, and influence, wants to tell us about the lives of the very rich, the masters of the universe, the people who marry into money, the blue-collar billionaires, ultimate risk-takers, celebrated frauds, and conspicuous consumption. But that's not all. They have another magazine they put out called Forbes Life, which just comes to the subscribers. This is the travel issue. Big trips to small places, because if you're a billionaire, you're not doing anything small. Now, then we make the transition to the other side of my brain. We start with Esquire. Let's take a look at that. Esquire, the best of 2010. It is a magazine that has had enormous staying power for very, very long. It is about, here we are, the multitasker, the duffel coat, okay? And it's geared toward men, but I've loved it since I was in my 20s. Los Angeles Magazine. If you live in Los Angeles, you want to know what's going on in Los Angeles. Then, too, one of the things that I picked up on the newsstand, and I still kind of hang on to this issue because I found it very beneficial, even though it was from last February, Psychology Today. Not only about First Love, First Lost, but look at the top article, How to Win American Idol. This one did very, very well on the stands, I might imagine. Now, I'm not a person that gets into fashion magazines because, frankly, I don't have a 28-inch waist anymore, so I don't really have need to find out what the latest men's skirt is about. But this is the movie issue, and it was coupled in with Variety. And the reason that's relevant is because when you have one magazine that needs to have a boost in circulation, they can partner up with another magazine and thereby get the same audience by giving it away once. Once you read this, you'll want to subscribe. Maybe not, but here's my real guilty pleasure. Decor magazines. Elle Decor. Elle is a fashion magazine. They have a decorated one. Dwell. That appeals to my green side. I'm very much of an eco-greeny. Architectural Digest. I kind of got the subscription by accident and decided to hang on to it. It's interesting to see enormously huge houses that are indeed conspicuous consumption that are not necessarily ever going to be probable in my life, but fun to look at. More realistic? House Beautiful. Look at this. Living room before and after. Do it in a day. How can you not want to do that? Traditional home decorating I also find interesting because it harkens back to that home and hearth kind of sensation. Now, there's Martha Stewart Living because Martha Stewart is, after all, guru number one. She was there first with the magazine. She took home economics, the class that nobody ever wanted to take, and turned it into a multi-billion dollar empire. Making a slightly more transition into lifestyle, here's Real Simple. Life made easier. How can you not want to have an easier life? Something more simplistic, something that will give you solutions. So a clean house with less hassle is very intriguing. And 18 products to make the everyday easier, I'm definitely going to want to know what they are. Vanity Fair. Sort of fashion, sort of news, sort of feature. It's kind of an all-purpose take with your magazine that's very comforting. And last but not least, the guru of modern times, Oprah. I'm sorry, she is my guru, and as much as I am surprised by it, when I was at the Governor's Conference on Women and Families, and I found myself in the sixth row when she came out a couple of years ago, I immediately stood, and much to my surprise, was urged to jump. She has inspired more women to do more of things that they didn't think they'd ever accomplish, and to be more introspective and more aware of themselves in life and the community. So her magazine is indeed a bestseller, and it must be in my house. Now, newspapers moving onto the internet, magazines are moving onto iPad. I can't really show you too much of this, but this is my new toy, and I found the first magazine that was presented by Virgin. And I don't know if we're going to be able to see it. This is what the new magazine is going to be like. Imagine all of the magazines that I just showed you loaded onto my iPad. And I can take this with me, and when it's facing me, I know which way to move it much more easily, and read these stories. And there are interactive pop-outs, and it's all there. And the price of this to download, $2.99 a month. That's the same or less than each of the magazines that I've put up on the table. So when we look at the future, this is just the beginning. Richard Branson is fascinating because he's always looking at what is next, what is exciting, what is hip. And I apologize for all the finger marks, but this is a really well-used tool. And as you go up, it'll keep telling you where to go and when to go there. At any rate, this is the future. And it's the future because, well, you can just take this and carry it and read everything and still have other functions and go on the internet. Past one sales of this little iPod are flying off the shelf. It's a tool that provides solutions. Speaking of Richard Branson, who is the entrepreneur behind Virgin Everything, Virgin Airways, Virgin Atlantic, Virgin Records, Virgin Space, Virgin Movies. Project Magazine is the first interactive magazine ever, and we're going to take a look at what he has to say about it. So let's go to it then.
Hi, everyone. We're coming at you from the launch event for Project, the first iPad-only magazine, I believe, in the world. And we're joined, of course, by Sir Richard Branson, the founder of Virgin, a senior member of our board of directors. Great to see you, Richard.
Good to see you, too.
Thank you for having us. So let's jump right into it. Tell us a little bit about Project. What is this all about?
Well, what is Project? Project.
Here's your elevator pitch.
Project is a magazine. But it's a magazine that you can only get on the iPad initially. In time, you'll be able to get it on lots of other devices. By putting it on the iPad, which it's been specially designed for, you can really bring a magazine alive. You know, the cover story is Jeff Bridges. Instead of just reading an article about Jeff Bridges, you can interact
with experience
Jeff Bridges, and experience Jeff Bridges. You can hear him talking about his films. You can see him walking and talking. And you know, it's just something which magazines have never been able to do before. And so, because it's specially designed for the iPad, it's got lots of bells and whistles that magazines have never had in the past.
Absolutely. We had fun playing with it today. I guess, you know, no pun intended, what drew you to this project?
Well, it's my daughter, Holly, who, you know, one of our people at Virgin Group came up with the idea. They went to Holly, who works in our new projects division of this project.
She's here with us today.
She's here today. And she pitched it, to myself and other senior people at Virgin. We loved the idea. We just thought, let's give it a go. We had a fantastic editor in Anthony who had a lot of experience. They've created 100 wonderful pages, and we've managed to keep the price low, $2.99 a month, we'll see if it works. I mean, I think the iPad is going to explode between now and Christmas, that people are going to want things to play with. Project is a great way of introducing yourself to the iPad.
And we've had fun playing with it today. So let me ask you, I mean, it seems like there are a lot of people these days talking about, you know, the iPad saving journalism, and it seems like the theme here today is that you want to rejuvenate journalism, you want to, open a new chapter in it. You know, really, going back in your entrepreneurial career, you started in the media and you've touched the media in different ways. What do you see as the future of the media?
Well, I actually think today gives you the best taste of what the future will be. For instance, advertising is pretty dull at the moment. Advertising in Project is really exciting. Instead of just getting an ad on a page, you can delve in and it comes alive. And you actually want to watch the ad, which you just don't want to. Don't want to do on television. You don't want to do in a normal magazine. So. And I think if you can bring advertising alive, that's often what pays for journalism.
You got to pay the bills.
That will result, I think, in lots of other projects getting off the ground. And I think this is just the start of a whole new revolution, and which will be great for journalism.
Taking a step back from this project, obviously you're possibly the world's busiest entrepreneur. I know you're jetting off to Dallas for the launch of Virgin America's service there. You know, I guess for our entrepreneurs that are watching this and have busy lives of their own, how do you balance it all with so many projects going at any given time? Obviously, you have a great team here at Virgin, but how do you keep everything in line?
By finding wonderful people. We've got 60,000 great people who work for Virgin, hopefully inspiring them, giving them a lot of freedom to go and try things. Sometimes we'll fall flat on our face, sometimes we won't. Having a blast myself, learning about, I hadn't even opened an iPad a month ago. And now I can, talk about iPad types.
And doing it on camera here.
I do it on camera. So I'm learning all the time, and I just love learning. But equally, I like to play hard, so I kite surf, and I play tennis, and I keep fit as well, which is very important.
And you have a lovely island, as we know. How important is fun as an entrepreneur?
I think fun is important for everybody in the world. I think businesses are apt to take themselves far too seriously. Most of the time people spend at work. People who run businesses should realize how important fun is, and they should make sure that people who work for them have a good time. You know, obviously people have got to work hard, but they've got to play hard as well.
Absolutely. And final question here, we're coming up on a new year, 2011. What's next for you? What's next for Virgin? And are you optimistic about the economy and things in general?
As far as optimism is concerned, I think it's up to businesses all over America and around the world to bring about that optimism. We've got to invest our money into new projects like this, which create jobs, and you know, dig ourselves out of the hole of far too many people being out of work. As far as next year is concerned, you know, I think with Virgin we've got lots of wonderful projects. Why not the Wind Project? We got
good plug there.
lots of great projects. I mean, Virgin America, we just launched in the States, a domestic airline. It's taking America by storm. We've got 50 new planes coming. Last Americans have a great domestic airline. I suppose the most exciting thing that's about to happen in the Virgin world is space travel.
You've conquered Earth. Let's go to space.
The sky's no longer the limit. So the spaceship is now nearly finished. The mothership is nearly finished. The Space Force is nearly finished. And so within 12 months, 15 months, we should be looking back down on this beautiful Earth and giving it away.
Absolutely. Well, it's great to see you as always. Thank you. Congrats on the launch.
Okay, so you see the key influence there is he does what he wants to do to have fun. And as a result, he's built enormous business potential there. Now, we're going to start moving very quickly over the next 10 minutes, so stay with me. As with all forms of media, magazines have the primary purpose of raising money. And that's what they do. They want enough editorial content to hold our attention, so we keep buying magazines and keep selling ad space. Advertisers want to reach specific consumers. So the tighter the niche, the better. You're not going to see the same people advertising in Martha Stewart Living as you are in Forbes magazine. Very, very rarely, maybe airlines and the ads themselves will be specifically tailored to the audience. Now, we make choices by the magazines we subscribe to, and they indicate certain things about us. Professional interests, hobbies, passions, and aspirations. So our choices enable the marketers to target their advertising to us more effectively. Which is really good for everybody, because frankly, I don't want to see ads for car oil. Frequently, magazines will ask us to provide information and demographic details. They want to know how many people live in your household, how many children do you have, what's your household income. I would always suggest nobody tell anybody that. What's your highest degree of education? What kind of things do you like to do? Do you want any of the following items? Do you intend to purchase any of them over the next 6 months? In short, they're asking us to provide them with the parameters of our demographics so they know what ads to put into the editorial content for us. In turn, they will continue to provide the editorial content that fulfills all of our needs. Magazine covers use specific predictable techniques in order to attract our attention. Words. You'll see them on all the magazines. Secret. Best. Perfect. Prizes. These are designed to incite emotion. Topics. Sex, love, and rock and roll, and all of its variations, along with money and business and power. Numbers. You're going to start seeing, now that I'm going to tell you to look, you're going to notice magazine covers will have 32 ways, 55 things, 93 recipes. Magazines have a historic rise in popularity, and one of the things that they honed in carefully was numbers get your attention. Let's take a look at a 2-minute clip very quickly about the power of print from publishers.
Facebook, YouTube,
Twitter. It's all anybody does these days.
Sit around and surf the web. That's it. And the internet's going to kill movies and books, and theater and television.
And it'll kill magazines too. Guaranteed.
Every new technology supposedly has to kill an older technology to make room for itself.
Radio was going to kill theater. Movies were going to kill radio.
TV was going to kill the movies. The VCR was going to kill TV.
And the internet was going to kill them all.
But that's not how media works.
What actually happens is that people find room in their lives for the new medium alongside the media they already love.
As long as those media continue to evolve and provide an irreplaceable value.
Bloggers and the pundits, of course, don't see it that way.
They continue to predict the death of the magazine and any other media to anyone who will listen.
But the rumors of our death are, as an old magazine guy once said, greatly exaggerated.
Merely myths.
That's why some of us in the magazine business, a fairly competitive bunch,
decided to join forces and do something about them.
We felt it was time to replace the myths
with what lies at the core of all great journalism.
The facts.
It's time to tell our side of the story. Story of magazine's power.
The story of magazine's strength
and scope, a unique cultural impact.
The story of magazine's particular relationship with our readers, a bond we share with no other medium.
The story, which will come as a surprise to many, of magazine's strength and vitality.
We're going to tell the story in the way that we know best, in print.
Its telling begins today.
Okay, so in order to understand the development of magazines, up to the point where they're all moving on to the iPad, let's take a look at historical reference, because this is the best way to understand our current experience. Norman Rockwell on the Saturday Evening Post. Many of us grew up in an age where the human experience was valued for its simplicity. Relationships were simple to have. Authority figures were simple to understand. We were more trusting of them. Honesty was valued, and honesty was in fact accepted. It was the rule rather than the exception. Problems could be solved in simple ways. Let's take a look at the next Saturday Evening Post cover. It's a boy and his sick dog. We cared about many of the same things we cared about then. Health and responsibility. Note the way in which the boy is carefully measuring out the medicine to give to the presumably sick dog. Another one. This is my favorite Saturday Evening Post. Motherhood was apparently much easier to manage. You had cooking, sewing, cleaning, and the PTA. Now, look at mom resting while the kids went on the school bus. Her day is over. She gets to relax until they come home. Today, the school bus is only picking up special ed kids, and you have to walk them right up to the bus. I don't know any mom who gets to kick back like this, certainly not me. By the way, the headline is, are British schools better than ours? We kind of know the answer to that now. Where are women looking today? Ladies' Home Journal. Here's one with the cover of Meredith Vieira. Ladies' Home Journal, according to these headlines, wants you to train your brain to help you lose weight. But it also wants you to cook some easy Thanksgiving recipes from the Barefoot Contessa. Then you need the perfect hairstyle. High pressure, not just a good hairstyle, the perfect hairstyle. After you've cooked all those recipes, your hair is supposed to look perfect too. Let's go to the next one. This is Insano with Catherine Heigl, who's one of the most beautiful women in the world. She's going to tell us what to wear now, the best new shoes, 90 steals under $50, 20 style rules you should break, 4 secrets, remember secrets, perfect secrets, best to amazing skin, increase the superlatives, and the one trick to sparkling eyes. Notice on magazines sell more issues, okay? If there are 20 style rules, psychologically you think, well, maybe I'll find 3 or 4 and get to follow. That might be helpful to me. Just one trick to sparkling eyes, well, it's just one thing I can do. I can do one thing. They're all juxtaposed by the perfect girl on the cover. Okay, this woman in life with no makeup on is as perfect looking as that. Now, let's look at another image of woman's life today. Wednesday magazine. The slogan is live well every day. Get energized. 25 feel great tips. The big health threat no one's talking about. How big could it be if no one's talking about it? If no one's talking about it, why should I? Look beautiful at any age. I don't know, 83, you're probably not going to be able to do too much to change that. But organize your whole life in a 3-week action plan. I've tried for many more than 3 weeks to organize my whole life. That's probably not going to be a really valuable article, but that will sell more magazines than anything else on this cover. We fall into the superlative syndrome. We are multitasking ourselves into ulcers. We have fear, insecurity, and only perfect is good enough. How do you possibly live up to that standard? Now let's look at the teenage girl and how she approaches this. Teenage girls have more pressure on them than any other time that we've had in history. 28 must try products. You must try them. Well, if your friend tried them, you must. If you're trying them, your friend's going to want to try them. Tips for super gorgeous hair and perfect skin. What teenager in the world can accomplish perfect skin? Really, why is the bar being set so high? Because this issue is full of ads for skincare products, and that's the bottom line. Who are they say will solve all of your skin problems? What happens to our society when our thought process is being adjusted to realize that good is never good enough unless it's perfect? This is Skin Magazine. Here's a copy from 1972 when I was an avid reader of this. With a wholesome fresh face on the cover. I wrote this magazine from the time I was 13 till the time I was 20. Okay, I believe Barbie dolls were too late too. But this magazine supported and encouraged everything I needed to transition into adulthood. It was like having a really nice friend who said, oh, here's something that works, try this. Promising fashions that you can count on, don't push you to be perfect. You can count on them. Do you need heroes? It helped us find inspiration and role models. 17 has enormous staying power. It's consistent with its target demographic, and teenage girls have the same needs over all the decades. Only the tone of the topics has changed. So what has it turned into today? Let's take a look at a recent cover. Not as kind and woman friendly. It's become a little more of the bitchy, gossipy girl who's you want to hang out with because she's popular, but you're hoping she's not going to be mean to you. It's a real friend kind of approach. You know, the secret life of the American teenager. The star is, quote, not the girl you think she is. 943 ways to look pretty for free? 943. Think about that number. Perfect skin without makeup. Again, not going to happen on a typical teenage girl's face. We need $250,000 for college. What college costs that much money? And to the kid who's looking at her from the point of view of her parents have very low-level blue-collar jobs, how can she possibly graduate college if the bar is set for her at that level? Finally, quote, the foolproof way to get any guy you want. Probably not. But at the bottom, it's going to say if you're gullible enough to buy that, quote, you could be tricked into getting pregnant. Now, let's go in another direction, to teenage boys. The National Lampoon magazine. This is an iconic cover from 1973. If you don't buy this magazine, we will kill this dog. National Lampoon used to be absolutely on the cutting edge. We all loved it. We all flocked to it. Girls, boys, adults, everybody. It was the cool kid to hang out with. Before and during Saturday Night Live's early years, this was a magazine that if you were hip, you read this. It's lost its weight. Maybe because society got a bigger bite, maybe because the folks who were running it just kind of got too old to hang out and be clever at that level again, or maybe because Gen X grew up a little bit too pampered. Rolling Stone magazine has staying power. Let's take a look at this one, famous for its cover art. This is Annie Leibovitz, a Bette Midler, when she was starring in The Rose. It's very consistent. It's a little seductive. It's humor. And is in keeping with the theme of the movie and the fabulous divine Miss Anne. Now let's look at the recent translation of that with Christina Aguilera. Kinda trashy. Okay, similar pose. The guitar is covering all the strategic locations, and the article is titled Inside the Dirty Mind of a Pop Princess. It's a far Disney Musketeer, along with Britney Spears, same class of Disney Musketeer queen. We're gonna take one more look at another magazine. The New Yorker magazine. And again, an iconic cover. Everything past 9th Avenue goes straight to the Pacific Ocean. It is a New York state of mind. The New Yorker is a magazine that is famous for having covers that don't necessarily match any of its editorial content. It's art for art's sake because it's from a city where art is popular conversation throughout the cultural levels. If you're a bus driver, you still probably know what's going on at the Metropolitan Museum. There is an awareness. Artistry takes place over recording the moment in history. It's almost like a snapshot of people's minds, and it definitely appeals to the targeted demographic. Now, like many women I told you before, art is my midlife crisis. Once you finish creating children, you kind of want to create something else. And why just scrapbook when you can create art? Let's take a look at the image for Somerset Studio Magazine. This issue lets those two worlds collide. It's called Jurassic Art. Where did this come from? Enough women had enough children with little toy dinosaurs sitting around, and they said, here's some creative projects to do with it. This is what magazines should do. They should give us pause to relax and to reflect. They shouldn't pressure us to be perfect in anything, and they should inspire us. Let us be inspired by Asian art is the caption here, not pressured to replicate it perfectly. at the end of a long workday, my husband, 30 seconds and every other chaotic distraction of modern life. Sometimes, truthfully, all I want to do is read about 15 different ways to make tincture with tissue paper. It's as simple as that. Magazine covers are like individual pieces of a jigsaw puzzle. They tell us a tiny part of who we are and the story of us as individuals and as society. They're like little tiny snapshots, and building together to create the full picture of who we are at this particular point in time. What is disposable ephemera is a cherished collectible to many people in the future. And truth be known, don't tell my husband, but I've got a whole stack of Somerset Studios magazines tucked away in the back of the closet, and occasionally I'll pull out one that's 5 or 6 years old and re-enjoy it. Now, we're going to go to my thesis on this whole theory that friendship videos are the future of entertainment as we know it. I'm going to save the explanation for the last episode of this program, but let's take a look now at this week's friendship video.
Thank you. Is indeed the future of entertainment as we know it. Let me know if you can start figuring out why. Send in your answers to Catherine@CatherineClinch.com or cclinch@csudh.edu. I'd love to hear from you. Now, this class is part of the Applied Studies Bachelor's Degree Completion Program. Classes are broadcast live on the Staple Television Channel and webcast over the internet every week. This spring, we're broadcasting four classes. Political Science 335, which is International Politics. That's Tuesdays from 7 to 9 p.m. Communications 100, Mass Media and Society. That's this course on Saturdays from noon to 1:40. Communications 300, Organizational Communications, on Saturdays from 1:50 to 3:30 p.m. And Sociology 315, The Sociology of Work, on Sundays from noon to 2 p.m. If you've completed 2 years of college, you can earn your bachelor's degree by enrolling in these classes. All of the courses you need to complete a bachelor's degree will be broadcast on this channel during the next 2 years, and then we'll start all over again. If you'd like more information about the Applied Studies Program, the Applied Studies Bachelor's Degree Completion Program, visit our website at www.appliedstudiestv.com or call 866-278-6789. Now, we've gone through this whole program, and hopefully you have achieved your three learning objectives. Let's take a look at those again one more time. By the end of this class, you will be able to understand the impact that disposable media has on society. Students will be able to demonstrate the emotional connections created by rhetoric and slogans. And students will be able to analyze the psychological power of certain words and phrases that are used in media headlines. As you are watching the TV for the next 2 weeks, watch carefully to the way that the events unfold in the story of the two sons. Okay? We're hearing about the miraculous recovery of Representative Giffords. It is amazing. Apparently, this woman is going to survive. She may actually be able to have all of her faculties intact. As we're watching that inspirational story, we're learning more about Shooter. We're learning about his previous history. And now that you've been shown how to look at the way rhetoric is impacting that, I would urge you to follow this story on both CNN, because it is my favorite network and we do want to keep it in business, and also going over to Fox News and see how they're covering it. It is the lone gunman on Fox News, and the problem is endemic to our current political approach in modern society on CNN. As part of that, you should be able to form an opinion at a different level than you had before. And here's an exercise to consider. It's not an assignment, but go to a newsstand and look around and see which magazines appeal to you. Read the covers. Know how many numbers. Know how many times issues are giving you the secrets. And then go home and look at your coffee table. Look in your mailbox. See what you've chosen to define yourself as. And by the time you're finished, you're going to have a little more insight into who you are and who our society is. Thank you so much. I'm Catherine Clinch. This has been Mass Media and Society. We'll come back next week and we'll talk about some other interesting things. Thank you.
You're watching VHD.